is the land of cotton. The first time you leave, it can be strange. It can be shocking. Not everybody drives a truck. Not everybody drinks sweet tea. Not everybody owns a gun, wears ball cap boots and jeans. Not everybody goes to church, watches every NASCAR race. Not everybody knows the words to Ring of Fire or Amazing outside my southern comfort zone. I've walked the streets of Rome. I've been to foreign lands. I know what it's like to talk, have nobody understand. I've seen the Eiffel Tower lit up on a Paris night. I've kissed a West Coast girl underneath the Northern Lights. I know what it's like to be the only one like me. Take a good hard look around and be in the minority. And then I miss my Tennessee home. I have been away way too long. I can't see this world unless I go outside my southern comfort zone. I can't see this world unless I go. I can't head on out to London, England unless I go outside my southern comfort zone.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everybody. I'm Brad Paisley. Great to have you here. I have three of my most trusted brain trust colleagues with me today to sort of sing some country songs for you blokes, or should I say blokes, and sort of talk to you a little bit about how we make this stuff that has you both entertained and puzzled. And first of all, this is it's a real thrill for us. That song that I just sang for you, Southern Comfort Zone, was written about my experiences of coming to Europe and seeing the world and going to places that are definitely outside the comfort zone for a West Virginia hillbilly like myself. And what's great about that song, first of all, it was co-written by Kelly here and Chris Dubois, Kelly Loveless, Chris Dubois, who co-write a lot of songs with me, among other people in Nashville. And one thing you'll notice about the things that we're going to talk about tonight as far as how we write these songs is we approach this slightly differently than some songwriters. We're always looking for the angle that hasn't been written. And to me, you could write 50 songs called Southern Comfort Zone about drinking on a tailgate in the South, and that's your Southern Comfort Zone. But I said, I like the idea of leaving that Southern Comfort Zone and seeing the world and going to London and riding on a double-decker bus and trying, you know, something made of intestines from a pig.
Haggis?
Haggis, yeah, right. And going back and realizing you don't like that, but you do really like the... you really do like fish and chips over there, and tea is better over here, isn't it? It's just better. Yes. You sometimes write something that just matters to you. And it's a big lesson. Write what you feel, you know? Write what matters to you. And it was also sort of a lesson in the sense that songs about life are really what country music is about. And the next song we're going to play you is something that became a massive hit for me. I've got some big news. The bank finally came through, and I'm holding the keys to a brand new Chevrolet. Have you been outside? Sure is a nice night. How about a little test drive down by the lake? There's a place I know about where the dirt road runs out. We can try out the four-wheel drive. Come on now, what do you say? I can hardly wait to get a little mud on the tire. It's a good night to be out there soaking up the moonlight. Stake out a little piece of shoreline. I've got the perfect place in mind. It's in the middle of nowhere. One way to get there, you gotta get a little mud on the tire. Then with a little luck, you might just get stuck. Let's get a little mud on the tires. This is Lee Miller.
Hello.
Get my pick.
Now let me say while he's getting his pick that I met Brad sometime in the late 90s, and we're getting to know each other, and he plays me a couple. I'm like, what do you need? What are you about? And so he sits down and he starts playing, and the first thing he said was, "Crap." He really, really plays great. But
can you say crap?
I don't know. We're out of the country.
I know. I said something on the radio the other day and got in trouble. I didn't realize it was the vernacular is a whole lot different.
Does crap even mean the same thing over here?
It doesn't. I don't know, but I know shag doesn't. I learned that the other night.
This makes me so uncomfortable. I'm still kind of walking on eggshells about that whole Revolutionary War thing, much less curse words.
We're sorry.
So anyway, I'm thinking, well, he's a great player, and he keeps playing, and I'm like, okay, he's a phenomenal player, okay, but I'm sure he probably doesn't write that much. He needs me, And so then he plays me some stuff he's cutting, and it's really, really good, and I'm like, okay, well, you need more of that. And he says, here's the truth. I've got enough for my first three records.
No, I didn't say
you did.
That.
You said, I've written the first three records,
I don't know
and I that. Thought, that's... absolutely not positive. The song he's got teed up to play for you is my first cut on Brad Paisley, and it's on album 4. That's a true story. You're the teller down at the bank. You're just another checking account. You're the plumber that came. Well, you're just another house. The airport ticket counter. Another thing. You sharp at the mall. Well, you just hit me. That's alright. That's okay. You don't feel important. Honey, all I got to say is to the world, you may be just another girl. But you're one in a million to me. You're wondering if you matter, baby. Look into my eyes and tell me, can't you see? But to the world, you may be just another girl. To me, baby.
You only got two lines of that. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
There's
okay.
more to come.
That's all right. It's not about me.
Everything's about you.
I know. I just wanted to say
no,
that.
No, I'm kidding. The thing about that song that I think is a really interesting thing, I listen to a lot of British music. I love Coldplay. I love the Beatles. I love the Rolling Stones. I love Mumford & Sons. There's just so much to me that you've gotten your revenge for the Revolutionary War in many ways musically, and it's not fair. But this is really, to me, a good example of how we would write something versus how a pop artist would write something. The pop artists do something I'm envious of in that they use metaphor and imagery and poetry, and you don't know what they mean. I don't know what Strawberry Fields is about. I know they've written articles about it, and they probably still don't know. And in our case, if you write Strawberry Fields, it's like, why you want to sing a song about Strawberry Fields? Because it's really going to be about Strawberry Fields.
If we write Strawberry Fields, there's a pickup truck parked in the middle of a strawberry field. Everybody's drunk and everybody's having sex, right?
That's probably right. The comment you get when you turn a song in is always, well, I don't understand what that means. If they have a criticism, it's frequently about the lyric, because it's always about connecting with your audiences. And we always feel like it's our job to paint a clear picture as writers in Nashville. And that's one of the things that I'm excited about as country music starts to take hold, I think, in the United Kingdom, is we're all the same. And as I go into this next song, which is something I wrote around the same time as Mud on the Tires, I was looking at the world and trying to figure out what is this thing we're obsessed with, and wrote a song called Celebrity. And I think it's the type of thing, this is a good example of the last thing you would think a country music song would be about. Someday I'm gonna be famous. Do I have talent? Well, no. These days you don't really need it, thanks to reality shows. Can't wait to date a supermodel. Can't wait to sue my dad. Can't wait to wreck a Ferrari on my way to rehab. 'Cause when you're a celebrity, it's adios reality. No matter what you do, people think you're cool just 'cause you're on TV. I can throw a major fit when my latte isn't just how I like it. They say I've gone insane, I'll blame it on the fame and the pressures that go with being a celebrity. I'll get to cry to Barbara Walters when things don't go my way. I'll get community service no matter which law I break. I'll make the supermarket tabloids. You have those, right? I've heard about them. Yeah, they're infamous. They'll write some awful stuff. The more they run my name down, the more my price goes up. 'Cause when you're a celebrity, it's adios reality. No matter what you do, people think you're cool just 'cause you're on TV. I can fall in and out of love, have marriages that barely last a month. When they go down the drain, I'll blame it on the fame and say it's just so tough being a celebrity. Thank you. That was, for me, a real stretch. That was my third record, and I was just starting to realize you can write these things that aren't typical country music topics. That was a really big hit, and it was the type of thing that felt like the floodgates were open as a writer. It was totally open for all of us. For me, it was like, we can write about anything. It doesn't have to be trains in prison. It can be all of these really fun topics that are going on in our lives. Although I think maybe train songs would be something you would relate to here, because we've somehow lost our love of trains in America, and you seem to have found it. But our next venture into this little territory was with a song similarly about what was going on in the world. And Chris and Kelly and I sat down to write one day, and I had this title that I had thought of, which was, I'm So Much Cooler Online.
Which I got to say, you know, Kelly and Lee and I, all three are very fortunate to get to write with a lot of artists around town. Rarely do these artists come in with song ideas, and if they do, they are some of the most boring ideas you've ever heard. That has never been the case with Brad. He walks in with an idea like, I'm so much cooler on the line, and then we're like, okay. I mean, that's what makes it fun as a writer.
Well, for me, the brilliance of Kelly and I, all of us feel like we can handle a lyric, but there's something about Chris Dubois and his warped mind that can take a lyric to a place you don't expect. And I'll show you when we get to the spot in this song where I think Chris actually earned his percentage of the of the song.
No, actually, I should have earned a bigger percentage, truth be told.
That's true. The pizza pit. I drive an old Hyundai. I still live with my mom and dad. I'm 5'3" and overweight. Hey, I'm a sci-fi fanatic, mild asthmatic, never been to second base. Yeah, there's a owner than me you need to see. Go check my Facebook page. I drive a Maserati, it's a black belt in karate, and I love a good glass of wine. Turns girls on, and I'm mysterious. I tell them I don't want nothing serious. Even on a slow day, I can have a three-way chat with two women at one time. I'm so much cooler online. Yeah, I'm cooler online. All right, let's try it. This is the verse where it takes such a left turn, and I'm in love with Chris's mind. Go.
I get home and I kiss my mom, and she fixes me a snack. I go down to my basement bedroom and fire up my Mac. In real life, the only time I've ever even been to L.A. is when I got the chance with the marching band to play tuba in the Rose Parade.
As you can see, that's just the most brilliant verse. It's like, I see this guy in my mind. I went to high school with him. And all of us are in some way this.
Well, the first thought I had was, it started with the image of, you know, the guy that used to ride the school bus home, and I can remember him. I'm not going to say his name, but he carried the tuba on the school bus every day. And no one sat by him because they couldn't. He was sitting by his tuba. And that's the guy that I had in my mind. And then that drifted into playing in the Rose Parade, and that's out in L.A. So that's what's fun about these songs is we're brainstorming constantly throughout them, and that's what makes the whole creative process fun.
You got my kind of stats, it's hard to get a date, let alone a real girlfriend. But I grow another foot and I lose a bunch of weight every time I log in. Go ahead.
Online, I'm out in Malibu. Cozy Calvin Klein, I'm in GQ. I'm single and I'm rich, and I got a set of six-pack abs that would blow your mind.
It turns girls on and I'm mysterious. I tell them I don't want nothing serious. Even on a slow day, I can have a three-way chat with two women at one time. I'm so much cooler online. Yeah, I'm cooler online. So much cooler online.
You ought to see me online.
Yes. Thank you for the food, Justin. Continuing the theme of the storytelling details of life aspect, Kelly and Lee and myself sat down to write one night. My wife was 9 months pregnant, 2 days prior to her due date. I walk over to Kelly's house. We write that day. And we're sitting there writing. We write a song that we're really proud of. So we go over to my house, and my wife is there with her sister. And we play her this song. We crack them up, totally crack them up, because this is a, and this is one of those songs that's sort of a crowd pleaser. So we walk back over, and we're high-fiving. I mean, we're just excited. And the phone rings, and it's her. My water broke. Not mine, hers. She says, my water broke. What do I do? And I'm like, I don't know. And I take off running as fast as I can back to the house. And it's absolutely perfect that this was the song.
And the last thing I heard Kelly yell as Brad disappeared in sight was, remember the last song you wrote before you became a father?
This is it. It's called I'm Still a Guy.
You see deer, you see Bambi, I see antlers up on wall. You see a lake, you think picnics, and I see a largemouth up under that log. I know that you're thinking that you're gonna change me in some ways, well maybe you might. Scrub me down, dress me up, all but no matter what, remember, I'm still a guy.
Your turn.
You see your priceless French paint, I see a drunk naked girl. You think that riding a wild boy sounds crazy, I'd like to give it a whirl. But love makes a man do some things he ain't proud of. In a weak moment, I might walk with your sissy dog, hold your purse at the mall. But remember, I'm still a guy.
I'll pour out my heart, hold your hand in a car, I'll write a love song that makes you cry. Turn right around, knock some jerk to the ground, 'cause he caught a feel as you walk by. These days,
dude's getting facials, manicured, waxed, and Botoxed, with deep spray on tans and creamy lotiony hands. You can't grip a tackle box.
Yeah, with all these men lining up to get neutered, it's hip now to be feminized. I don't highlight my hair, I've still got a pair. Yeah, honey, I'm still a guy. My eyebrows ain't plucked, there's a gun in my truck. Oh, thank God, I'm still a guy.
Thank you. So, what's crazy about it is as I sing this to you, I'm thinking, what's your version of this? Because certainly the vernacular, the words have to be a little bit different. Like, for instance, what do you hunt in England? Boar? Is it wild boar?
Love.
Pheasant. That's not going to sing well. See, when you see a bird, you see Daffy? I don't know. I see pheasants. On the wall? That doesn't make sense. I know the last verse is different, which is, my eyebrows ain't plucked, there's a gun in my truck. That's not going to happen here. Not going to happen here at all. Anyway, but as you can see, that was the perfect song to have written right as your wife is about to give birth. And I fell asleep in the chair, and which she reminds me constantly that I was almost missed it being asleep.
Well, we had worked late, in your defense. I mean, it was...
That's true. This next song is something that I really feel... it's probably one of the songs I'm the most glad I ever wrote. Mostly because I wrote this about what it was like for me as a high school student. It's a terrible experience in America. I don't know if it's a dark time for you. Yes, she's nodding. Is it a dark time for you here as well? Yeah. Do they have what they call jocks here? The athletes. Yes, the athletes can make it very tough on guys like me that aren't very fast. And anyway, I wrote this song about it. And since then, I've had so many high school students say that this helped them through some of the darkest times they've had. If I could write a letter to me and send it back in time to myself at 17, first I'd prove it's me by saying, look under your bed, there's a skull can and a Playboy, no one else would know you hid. Then I'd say, I know it's tough when you break up after 7 months. And yeah, I know you really liked her, and it just don't seem fair. But all I can say is pain like that is fast, and it's rare. And oh, you got so much going for you, going right. But I know at 17 it's hard to see past Friday night. She wasn't right for you, but still it feels like there's a knife sticking out of your back, and you're wondering if you'll survive. But you'll make it through this, and you'll see you're still around to write this letter to me. The stop sign at Tomlinson and 8th always stop completely, and don't just tap your brakes. And when you get a date with Bridget, be sure the tank is full. On second thought, forget it, that one turns out kinda cool. Each and every time you have a fight, just assume you're wrong and Dad is right. You should really thank Miss Brinkman, she spends so much extra time. It's like she sees the diamond underneath, and she's polishing you till you shine. And oh, you got so much going for you, going right. But I know at 17 it's hard to see past Friday night. Tonight's the bonfire rally, but you're staying home instead. Because if you fail algebra, Mom and Dad will kill you dead. But trust me, you'll squeak by and get a C. And you're still around to write this letter to me. You got so much up ahead, you'll make new friends, and you should see your kids and wife. Looking back, wait. What is it? I'm sorry, I can't understand your accent. Oh, yeah. And I'd say, have no fear. You are nowhere near the best years of your life. I've never heard that with a British accent before. That's basically the song. But anyway, I... I can remember the first few times I tried to sing that, I couldn't get through it, because it was something about it that was so powerful in that sense. And I never dreamed anybody else would care, but what I came to find out, and I think exactly the case here today. We're all the same. And I realized if you write a song like that that's so personal to you, that's the trick in country music. That's what really always works, almost without fail. And speaking of country music and what is it, that conversation comes up all the time. You probably have that conversation if you're fans of it at all. What is country music? What makes it country? And so we wrote a little song about it. It goes like this. You're not supposed to say the word cancer in a song. And telling folks that Jesus is the answer can rub them wrong. It ain't hip to sing about tractors, trucks, little towns, and mama. Yeah, that might be true, but this is country music, and we do. Do you like to drink a cold one on the weekend and get a little loud? Do you want to say I'm sorry or I love you, but you don't know how? Do you wish somebody had the nerve to tell that stupid boss of yours to shove it next time he yells at you? This is country music, and we do. So turn it on, turn it up, and sing along. This is real, this is your life in a song. Yeah, this is country music. This is country music. He stopped loving her today. Hello, darling. God bless the USA. Amarillo by morning. Stand by your man. I walk the line. A country boy can survive. I should have let him talk those at the end. That would have been good. Well, we got another one. I'll let you recite it at some point here. Actually, let's move up to a song that featured a British man on it. I'm a huge Monty Python fan, so I became friends with Eric Idle in America. I got to know him a few years ago. He's just as wonderful as you might imagine if you don't know him. And we started writing a song. Kelly had an idea. The idea was called Back to Life. And his original idea was just probably about a heartbreak or something. You know, hey, I'm coming back to life after the girl left and that. And somehow one of us came up with this idea. I don't know which one of us it was.
Now, the reality of it is sometimes when we're writing songs, we get way off topic. And that was an example of us. I don't even think we were talking about songs. We started just wondering what would happen legally if somebody was declared dead and then came back to life. And then we just laughed about that whole thing. And then next thing you know, we started writing a song about it. And it was one of the most creative co-writing sessions that the three of us have ever had together, because it really did feel like the song was born in that room that day. And it took turns that none of us expected, but it made us all laugh.
Can you guys do the whistling?
We'll give it a go.
Thank you.
Harvey Bodine died at 11:09. He left behind a miserable wife. But at 11:14, his heart came back on the screen. Thanks to that defib machine, he came back to life. Oh, but those 5 minutes were heaven, a peace unlike he'd ever known. As he came back to the
He thought, please.
He thought, please, God, don't make me go.
That's right.
Back to life. And they told him what happened. How that green line had flattened. Old Harvey just started laughing. He said, you're telling me I died. And he thought about that woman, how she treated him for years. All the yelling and the screaming, and the light nagging and the tears. And the way it wasn't really all that bad when he lost his life. Oh, and those 5 minutes were heaven, a peace unlike he'd ever known. He called his lawyer, he called his priest, and told him about how they'd restarted his heart, how his wedding vows were technically till death do us part. You'll probably judge me, but boys, so be it. You know, boys, here's how I see it. Harvey Bodine died at 11:09. And he left behind, that was terrible whistling.
That was Chris.
A miserable wife. Oh, but at 11:14. His heart came back on that screen. Thanks to that defib machine, he's come back to life.
One of my favorite parts of that. One of my favorite parts of that song is actually not technically the part of that song. It's a prelude called "Death of a Married Man," and sing a piece of that. The part that leads into it.
This is what Eric Idle sings on the Wheelhouse album. Actually, Eric sings this, which I've always thought. I always wanted to have him sing something of mine. It's with a British accent. I'll try. I had a heart attack when I was playing charades. Everybody yelled, heart attack! And it was too late.
And then that goes into Harvey Bodine.
Goes into Harvey Bodine.
I love that.
You know, several years ago now, seems like only yesterday, but we had just elected President Obama. And as a, I was in New York City on that day because I released an instrumental album called Play on the very day, so I was doing a lot of press. And in our lifetime in America, I never imagined I would see a black man elected president. Never imagined it. And I was so sort of apolitically very, very proud of our nation for just the fact that it was willing to do so. It's not a simple thing in our country. It's a very complicated thing. So as the months went on after that, watching what happened in Times Square, you would see strangers, blacks and whites, hugging, saying, you know, yay. It was just like, it was this strange feeling of accomplishment and solidarity for a brief time. And months went away, it passed, and I remember thinking, where are the songs about progress? You know, throughout the course of history, there have always been songs about sort of monumental events and things that feel like shifts in the public consciousness or whatever. And months later, there still seemed to be none, and people were singing about the same old things as if the world hadn't changed. So I spent the next few days writing this song, and it was very, very interesting the way it came together. When I was 10 years old, I remember thinking how cool it would be. We were going on an 8-hour drive. If I could just watch TV, I'd have given anything to have my own Pac-Man game at home. Used to have to get a ride down to the arcade. Now I've got it on my phone. Hey, glory, glory, hallelujah. Welcome to the future. My grandpa was in World War II. Fought against the Japanese. He wrote 100 letters to my grandma. Mailed them from his base in the Philippines. I wish they could see this now. The world they saved has changed. You know, 'cause I was on a video chat this morning with a company in Tokyo. Happened right in front of me. I had a friend in school running back on the football team. They burned a cross in his front yard. We're asking out the homecoming queen. I thought about him today, and everybody who's seen what he's seen. From a woman on a bus to a man with a dream. Hey, wake up, Mom. Martin Luther. Welcome to the future.
Thank you.
So, would you like to hear something you've never heard? We've been writing for a new album, which is getting close to being ready. Going to come out in the summer. Lee and I wrote one that's a love song of sorts.
Not anything weird.
It's not for him. It's for his wife, which was weird because I wrote most of this.
But she's going to love it.
She's going to love it.
It's almost like you know her.
If she was a drink, she'd be single barrel bourbon on ice. Smooth with a kick, a chill and a burn all at the same time. She's Sunday drive meets high speed chase. She ain't just a song, she's a whole mixtape. She's so complicated, that's the way God made her. Sunshine mixed with a little hurricane. And she destroys me in that t-shirt. And I love her so much it hurts. I never meant to fall like this, but she don't rain, she pours. Well, that girl right there's the perfect storm. I know how to make her laugh or blush or mad at me. That's okay, there ain't no one more beautiful like me. And she loves just as deep as she goes when she's down. The highs match the lows, can't have one without the other. And I love her just the way God made her. Sunshine mixed with a little hurricane. Me in that t-shirt, and I love her so much it hurts. I never meant to fall like this, but she don't rain, she pours. That girl right there's the perfect storm. I never meant to fall like this, but she don't rain, she pours. That girl right there's the perfect storm. I set out a few years ago, and it's funny, you know what? Even when I write a song by myself, I feel like I have these guys help, because I can call them and say, as I'm writing a verse, how's this? And they'll say, terrible. Or, great, you need any help? Nope. But this is a great example of a song that I kept running by you guys and running by you guys for a while and saying, this is my idea, this is what I want to do. And they, for a while, thought I was a little nuts. Okay, I don't know how you're gonna pull that off, I think. And then all of a sudden it became this, and it didn't really become what it is until I changed it from talking about something to being that exact thing you're talking about. I can make anybody pretty. I can make you believe any lie. I can make you pick a fight with somebody twice your size. I've been known to cause a few breakups. I've been known to cause a few births. I can make you new friends. or get you fired from work.
Everybody.
And since the day I left Milwaukee, Lynchburg and Bordeaux, France, I've been making the pubs lots of big money and helping white people dance. Yeah, I got you in trouble in high school. Sorry, secondary. College now, that was a ball. You had some of the best times you'll never remember with me. Alcohol. You want to sing the second verse? You got to blame each other.
Go, go ahead, Chris. He's looking at you.
Recite it.
You got blamed at your witness session.
Oh, okay.
I got blamed.
All right.
Go.
Got blamed at your wedding reception for your best man's embarrassing speech, and also for those naked pictures of Brad Paisley at the beach.
They're out there if you'd like to see them.
I've influenced kings and world leaders. Helped Hemingway write like you did.
And I'll bet you a drink or two I can make you put this lampshade on your head.
And since the day I left Milwaukee, Lynchburg and Bordeaux, France, or Scotland, could have said that. I've been making a fool out of folks just like you, helping white people dance. I am medicine and I am poison. I can help you up or make you fall. You had some of the best times you'll never remember with me. We'll do you one more now. This is something that it's only appropriate that we sing over here. I got the idea in Europe. I'm fortunate enough, I've toured here many, many times. Finally went to Paris. I know y'all aren't big fans of France. But you really should try it sometime. It's very nice. Don't tell them you're English. Canadian, that's what we do. We're Canadian. The thing about it, I finally got to see the Mona Lisa. It's not my favorite painting in the world until I see it. And when I see it, there is something about it. It captivates you. It grabs you. It's like, that's the most famous, most coveted piece of art in the entire world. So you're looking at this thing, and everyone else is just crying and sobbing and looking, and there, people have reactions to this thing. And I'm thinking, what's the deal with the frame? Seriously. If you're a frame, that's the gig. That's really the gig. It's like, no better gig, you know. Another frame is on, like, dogs playing poker. Same size. This frame's on the Mona Lisa. Kind of like us with our wives, you know. Some guy got so-and-so. I got her. I don't understand how that happened. You know, and I really started thinking that's a real love song, and Chris and I started to write that, but we didn't want to do... I feel like the frame gets to hold the Mona Lisa. Which isn't bad, actually, now that I hear it that way.
Yeah, that sounds pretty
not
good.
Not bad.
You know? Y'all are recording this, right? Like, we could have that for...
No, I mean, this idea for the Mona Lisa is one of the best song ideas I've ever heard come out of his mouth. And that's perfect for just your classic love song. And he wants to write it like a Bruce Springsteen rock and roll song. And that's just, and I love what it became.
But I think when you fall this in love, you want to shout it from a roof. Now there are men who make history. There are men who change the world. And there are men like me that simply find the right girl. In that very moment, it all becomes clear what I'm meant to do. the reason I'm here. Now every night I thank the Lord I found you. Every time I put my arms around you, I feel like a rain gets to hold the Mona Lisa. And I don't care if that's all I'll ever do. It never fails. We walk in a room, nobody sees me, they're all looking at you. I disappear, that's fine with me. I feel the same way, you're all I can see. They've written books about Da Vinci's muse. I know it wasn't, but it should have been you. Cause I feel like a frame gets to hold on, Lisa. And I don't care if that's all. Recite a chorus, please.
I feel like the frame that gets to hold the Mona Lisa. And I don't care if that's all I ever do.
One more time, Frank.
Whoa, 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 whoa,
whoa, whoa, whoa. Thank you guys very much for having us. Hope you had a great time. We loved it.
Thank you.